Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Dirt, Growing Strong Roots in What Makes the Broken Beautiful by Mary Marantz, narrated by Mary Marantz. Please stay tuned after the closing credits for a bonus audio exclusive. For Dad, Mom, and Goldie, who loved the girl in the trailer. For Justin, who loved the girl after the trailer. I have been born a new thing, this time one with both roots and wings. For the people of West Virginia who are unshakable proof of the indomitable spirit that grows wild in the mountains there, this story belongs to all of us. Prologue. His hands looked even dirtier than I'd remembered, resting against the crisp, white, sterile sheets of a bed tucked away in the far-flung outer reaches of the hospital corner. I was standing in the same hospital I'd been born in some 36 years earlier, in the spring of 1980, when Mom was already a wife of 3 years, just 2 months shy of her 21st birthday, and he had yet to find his way to wanting to be a father. But from the first time he held me, I had been my father's child, and that had been both our unraveling and the common thread that stitched us back together again. Once we had known what it was to roar at one another, to shout and spit and fight and rail against one another, with all the similarities in us that drove us to our differences. With all the stubbornness and set in our ways that made us both so very much the same. We once knew what it was to fight with one another and for one another, to hold on with a white-knuckle grip when everything and everyone around us was letting go, and now the blip, blip, blip of the machines, casting their pale green light on everything standing between us, my leaving, my running, my staying gone, was the loudest noise in the room. It had been 5 years since I had been back home. Not since we laid Goldie in the cold September ground, when Dad and I sat under a cheap tent awning covering her newly opened wound of a grave long after everyone else had gone. We held on to each other and cried stinging, biting tears as the rain picked up all around us and thrummed out a holy, haunting, rhythm-turned hymn on the vinyl above. A few hours before the tent, I had stood in a small, red velvet-clad funeral home and delivered the eulogy for my beloved grandmother to a room only half full of people, a few of which might have just preferred it if I'd stayed gone. I hadn't been bothered to be there when she died, so why should I be the one to get the final word? A day later, Dad moved from our old brown single-wide trailer into Goldie's little red, suddenly empty house next door, the same house where he had both grown up and grown up way too fast, while my mom went back to her motel. A year later, he was vomiting up blood every day. It would come upon him with such a suddenness and violence that it didn't so much spill out of him as erupt from his lips. He rarely made it to the bathroom in time, and as such, Goldie's pristine green carpeting, the same she had chosen 15 years prior because it perfectly matched her pretty pink and green flowered couch, was now streaked in deep shades of dark, dried crimson. Battle stripes that perfectly matched the starry dots of the same kind splattered on the ceiling above. Had she not already been dead, the sight of it surely would have killed her. I could just picture her now up there on the top of Hokum Holler, where our family cemetery rested in a small field surrounded by a sentinel of overgrown weeds, where I like to imagine that the ghosts of our ancestors herald you up the twisting, turning knots of dirt road, rushing and whispering beside a motorcade of black cars as they made their unhurried, mournful crawl up the mountainside, ushering the next body on to its resting place, with a refrain as low and lonesome as the slow pull of rosin on strings. Kindred souls just walking each other home. There in my mind, Goldie would be doing exactly what she always said she'd do if any of us ever did something to disappoint her, spinning in her grave and cussing like a sailor under her dissipated breath, despite the good church lady she'd always been. Being my father, a man known far and wide for such bumper sticker faith as "I'm tough, I can take it," and "Oh, it'll be all right," it had taken him far too long to go to the doctor. Now his insides were eaten up with the cancer, 3 tumors that had grown into one. He had lost 60 pounds through the ordeal, and it had mined and hollowed out his face in such a way, aged him 20 years seemingly overnight, that I could hardly recognize him now. My breath caught in my throat when I walked into the dim light of that hospital room and saw him, a man much older than I had left him. I had to look away so he wouldn't see the horror in my eyes. And I was left staring at his dirty hands, leaving marks on the crisp white sheets. They were the only thing left about him that I recognized. From the hallway, I could hear the nurses at their station. Their accents sounded both foreign and familiar at the same time, like the two different versions of myself that I now held inside me couldn't agree on which one it was. There was the me who was the girl in the trailer, and then there was the me who came after, and they had both come to stand by my father's bedside, knowing full well they should have come much sooner. It had been 5 years since I had been home to Nicholas County, West Virginia, but I hadn't lived there in 18, and at that moment I was, in every way, both a girl and a woman divided. 18 years at home and 18 years since I'd left, I had just crossed some unspoken threshold of a finish line where I'd now spent as much of my life outside of that trailer as I had in it. And thinking back on it right then, it felt much less like a memory and more like another lifetime. In the flickering green, beeping darkness, Dad's eyes rolled forward, slow, wincing, as if that effort alone might finish him, blinked and then opened. "Hey, kid. How we doing?" It had been years since he called me kid, not since I left for law school at Yale, and he finally, for the first time in my life, started calling me Mary. He'd visited me exactly twice in New Haven in the 3 years I was in school there, once to help me find an apartment and once to move me in. Neither visit was to come back and watch me walk across that stage when I graduated. A lifetime of work to help get me to that place, and he wasn't even there to witness it. But I had at least graduated to my given name, and that felt like something. So to hear him call me kid now, in the small, still darkness of this unfamiliar room, it felt like he wasn't so much in another place as another time. My first thought was that they must have him on some powerful pain medicine and that through an IV-induced fog, he was just pretty out of it. I traced the tube coming out of his arm to a clear bag of liquid hanging from a metal stand and churning out its drip, drip, drip rhythm, till all the drips and blips in the room seemed to be keeping time with one another, and I felt like I might lose my mind at the repetition and replaying of it all. It was like scenes from a projector reel were casting mere shadows of our life, both he and I together and he and I apart, on the sanitized, whitewashed walls all around us. They blurred and bled into one another in a way that began to rewind time, my past, present, and future all melting into one, and I couldn't bring myself to look at anything but the hands that helped build me. Kid, kid, kidster, I was praying that you'd come. Now I was certain. The time to be worried was here. The only church on Sunday where J.R. Bess had ever worshipped was at the altar of the woods. His congregation was a canopy of trees ripe for the cutting. His preacher was a busted-up, run-down John Deere 550 dozer, always pushing him, driving him on toward his higher power. To me, he was not a man who ever seemed to be on real good terms with God. And to take one look at the struggle that was his life, it would be easy to assume that God had been more than fine with that arrangement. As far as I knew, Dad hadn't prayed for anything or anyone a day in his life, and I had no idea why he'd be starting now. Part 1. The Girl in the Trailer. Chapter 1. It Always Started with Dirt. From the edge of a dirt path off of Airport Road, where the road forks and snakes just a little taller to form the highest point on Fenwick Mountain, you can stand and watch a storm roll in from any and all directions. We would do that often when I was little. We'd stand out under the wooden overhang of a hand-built lean-to turn front porch, where the boards were all mismatched scraps of whatever you could find and the nails half-hammered and crooked sat rusted from the punishment of a blistering summer sun, and watch as streaks of lightning lit up the heat of a July night sky, while thunder rumbled hard and shook the mountains. Dad stood next to me in his muddy jeans and a long-since yellowed white undershirt, his bare, battered feet on the dirt floor of the porch, his dark hair wild as if standing on end at the electricity of it all. "Sure is pretty, ain't it, kid? You know, if you listen close and count, you can tell how far away it is." The next lightning flashed and we started counting together. We only got to 2 Mississippi before we heard that low rumble of thunder rising up again. This storm wasn't coming. It was already on top of us. When the rain came, it washed over us in sheets and waves, hammering out a Johnny Cash train track get a rhythm on the tin can roof of our single-wide trailer that paired nicely with the lonesome whistle-will of the wind through the chimes Mom had hung just outside my window. A true West Virginia lullaby, if ever I heard one. That night, as we stood and stared into the face of the storm, the kind of earth-shaking furor that makes you feel like the hand of God itself is hovering just a few feet above the ground with a finger pointed directly at you, we froze as lightning met ground just 2 houses down and their transformer lit up and started sparking like a Roman candle. The house was spared, but the garage burned down, and with it, the family dog. Well, technically he died when the fire department answering the call had to shoot him to put him out of his misery, but he was lost nonetheless. The mountain I come from was never easy on animals. I was not a beautiful child, gap-toothed with a mess of wild, curly brown hair, the chemically altered kind so synonymous with the 80s and that decade's particular love of cheap home perms, big hairspray bangs, and the chance to change whatever lot in life you'd naturally been given. I had eyes that were set too close together, lips that were far too thin, and to add insult to injury, my father's nose set right in the middle to remind all the other features that they were playing far too small. In the summer of 1989, you would have found me bare-legged and slightly bloody from the latest round of briar patch scratches, shouting out an answer over my shoulder at the request to be back by dark while lighting out as fast as my gangly, all too tall for my age limbs would carry me across the overgrown field behind our trailer. I was forever making my way into the deep, dark woods that lay just beyond the weeds, beckoned ever onward by their siren call. In the shelter in the shadow of the woods, I could be whoever I wanted. There are a lot of things I'm going to tell you about how I grew up, but before we get there, I need you to know something. This part, the part with the woods, well, I wouldn't change that at all. From birth until I left at 18, I grew up on the very top of a mountain in rural West Virginia in a single-wide trailer that was one part wood for every three parts aluminum. Every winter, the roof of its lean-to shack would crack and pop under the weight from the 22 inches of a Nicholas County snowfall. The old wood stove was never properly fitted at the top, causing flames to shoot out and streak overhead every time a log was thrown on. And orange and blue blazes danced perilously close to the pink panther fluffs of insulation that hung from the sagging ceiling above. When spring came, it rained just as hard inside as out, and the smell of mildew hung thick in the air long past the end of summer, clinging to your clothes and your very dignity. And I can tell you that long after the storm was over, those dark waters kept pouring down. The floors were made of soggy pieces of particle board still soaked from the storms that ran ragged through a tin metal roof the month before. Boards that were now more or less being held together by the threadbare patches of a brown shag carpet hopscotching its way across the living room floor, mere remnants of the days when the trailer was new. Now it was caked solid with a mix of old animal droppings and new chunks of mud every night from Dad's logging boots, until you couldn't tell where the brown carpet ended and the dirt began. And it was home. When I tell people this thing about me, this preamble into who I am, you can see the uncomfortable sit upon their shoulders and start to get heavy, like a weight they never asked to bear. They'll shift and unsettle and say things like, well, thank goodness you got out. Thank goodness that's not you anymore. And that's where they would be wrong. To be sure, I hated that trailer growing up. Hated everything about it. I would spend hours sitting outside with a pencil and a blue spiral-bound notebook, drawing sketches of it, dreaming up ways to build walls around it, put a roof over it, to somehow transform it and therefore me and my future overnight. I dreamed every day of what it would look like for our trailer to become a real house, as if that alone might give me a real chance at life. We could put beams all the way around the trailer, like spider's legs right into the ground, I'd tell Mom when I showed her my sketches. You could dig holes and pour concrete around them like you did for the swing set, and that would be enough to support a real roof. I just knew that if I could come up with the right set of plans, a blueprint of sorts for the life I wanted to build, then Mom and Dad would catch the vision, and I could bring them along with me, could save them from the world and from themselves from the series of unfortunate decisions, and then we could build that good life together, side by side by side. Or if they couldn't or wouldn't be convinced, then I would just go out and build it myself. So yes, I have known since I was little that one way or another, whatever else I had to do to make it happen, I would get out of that trailer and make a different life for myself. But to say that's not me anymore, well, that's where you'd be wrong. Everything I am begins and returns to that trailer. And everywhere I go, whoever else it is that I've become along the way, I carry that trailer with me. For me, this life, dug out and rebuilt from the ground up, has turned out to be much less a story about any kind of success than it is a song of redemption, a reconciliation with the roots that grew me, a melody born out of the muddiest parts of my life. Because as for me and my story, it always started with dirt. Year-round, I dumped scraps of brown beans and cornbread for the latest stray that had wandered into the yard. They were all kept in line by one feral gray tabby cat who adopted me as its own when I was just 4 years old and found it abandoned at the old elementary schoolyard in New Hope. It came up to me purring with its green eyes and the distinctive shape of an M in the fur on its forehead, which I just took as a sign that we belonged together. So I wrapped that kitten in my favorite blanket and snuck it home, where I tentatively named it Thomas, until a year later when she had kittens and was henceforth and forevermore known as Thomasina. We had a steady revolving door of stray dogs and cats turned temporary pets growing up, and none of them met a very happy ending. They would run away or disappear overnight, get hit by a truck that was going by a little too fast, get dropped off on the side of the road up some holler when we couldn't keep them, or get sick with what would have probably been a pretty curable fix if we ever actually took our animals to the vet. Instead, they would die right where they lay. Or once, Mom called our neighbor next door, the one with the shotgun, and that was that. "I hate to see an animal suffer," was all she said. Those were the welcome kind of pets I knew growing up, but this trailer of ours had plenty of unwelcome ones as well. It was thick with mice in the winter and small roaches skittering all over everything in the summer, and often I'd even find the wiggling, churning, blanched white bodies of maggots writhing in the kitchen sink and making a meal out of last week's dinner. I was 9 years old the first time I figured out that if you poured a gallon of bleach directly on their little white bodies, they would curl up in a ball and die right where they lay. The magic of Clorox, indeed. And yes, being right in the thick of the wilds of West Virginia, there were plenty of wood snakes and brown snakes, and also the occasional rattlesnake. Once, when Dad and I were on the couch watching some show together, a big, fat, hissing snake came right over the top of the television at us, interrupting our programming indefinitely that night. I'm guessing it just wanted to watch a different channel, but I was pretty shook up, nonetheless. I can tell you right now, I was never sad when any of them met an unhappy ending. But the dogs and cats were a different story. I think the hardest one ever was our black lab mix, who had just had puppies. One of our neighbors put out a bowl of antifreeze for her, punishment for wandering into his yard once too often. And before we caught it, she had passed it on to her nursing pups. In the space of one day, we lost them all. They curled up in a ball and died right where they lay. One by one, we laid them all out in the grass, silent and unmoving, until no hope was left. That was the first time I ever saw Dad cry. As he rocked that dog back and forth in his arms and buried his face in her sleek, black, bristly fur, the foam at her mouth mixing with the tears on his cheeks, I could hear him whispering, "Don't go, don't go, don't go." I knew right then this world sets out to hurt you. And that was just the hand dealt from the decidedly indifferent God I thought I knew back then. A God who allowed suffering and would go along and let this house be fine and that house be fine and then strike down the next one without any warning. He was the God who would stand by and let innocence be washed away in sheets like the rain from a hot summer storm. And I just knew he was coming for me next. God never started out for me as someone I feared. In fact, the earliest memory I have of God is lying in bed at night, talking to him through the windows in my room as he sat among the stars. My bedroom was on one end of the trailer, where the farthest wall was made up of three threadbare aluminum windows that looked out toward Goldie's little red house. I say threadbare because at the time, not a one of those windows had a curtain or a blind on it. I guess back then I was still at an age where things didn't need to be kept hidden. God could look right in on my life and see everything. When darkness fell and it was brighter outside than inside, it was as if the whole sky lit up like a silvery screen of stars. The windows were propped half open, and the warm summer air crawled in and curled up beside me. It brushed up against my bare legs, soft like fur, sighed and settled in. I guess I was still at an age where things didn't need to be kept out, either. When the summer air couldn't sleep, it danced pirouettes on the blankets and twirled all around the room, floating freely and without fear on a current of innocence and security. I turned my face to the sky and talked to God just like he was a friend. And he in turn seemed to come down and hover just outside my window, his breath close enough to leave fog marks on the glass. Goldie's little red house always still had a few lights on inside, and some nights I could see her walking around in there, her soft face glowing in the darkness. All the neighboring houses on our mountain were already dark. We were but a firefly in a vast, distant sky. So on those nights it seemed as if there was no one else in the world but me and God, and sometimes Goldie. This was not a God I ever remember anyone telling me about. This was not the wrathful God I would later meet in church, someone to be afraid of. and it was not the exclusive God I would later see some people make him out to be, someone who told other people they didn't belong with him. This was the God I seemed to have always known as a best friend, the one who came and visited me at my window, face to face and free of fear. He was the God who drew close enough to leave marks across my life, long before anyone told me what he should be. Shortly after that, God started meeting me outside in the yard during the daylight hours. When he wasn't in the stars, he was everywhere. He was in the green of the grass, down to the very pigments. He was in the birds stepping into flight, wings spread wide in defiance of gravity far from the tether of their branches. He was in the sun shining down on my face, the kind of gold from the fire that you know is still there even when you close your eyes. He was in the way that thin layers of mud, once dug out from the cold, hard ground, would dry on your hands and stay with you the rest of the day, as if once it left its mark on you, you couldn't forget how it felt. He was color and freedom and fire and dirt. And his was the voice that told me someday all of this was going to make so much sense. He was going to use it all, the messy, the hard, the broken, the beautiful. One day he was going to put words to it, and then I'd see. My story wouldn't be wasted. Chapter 2. You have to dig down to get to the good parts. We shared a yard with Goldie. Or rather, our trailer had been hauled in on an 18-wheeler flatbed truck and dropped on the back half of her property as a temporary solution that somehow turned permanent. So when you drove up Airport Road and made the first right down a dirt path driveway, it was Goldie's little two-bedroom redwood-stained house that you saw up front facing the road, and our single-wide trailer, propped up on a precarious-looking pedestal of cinder blocks, the ever-unpleasant surprise waiting behind it. Eventually, Mom and Dad built on a porch and put up wood skirting all around the bottom to give it a more finished look. But it was still one of those proximity problems with your in-laws situations that seemed to make all parties involved equally unhappy. The yard between our two houses was dotted with stuff. A pickup truck on blocks, a pickup truck that actually worked, a 1970s Firebird Trans Am gold with a giant eagle on the hood that seemed to actually fly when Aerosmith came on the radio. There was a camper, a loader, the occasional dozer that came caked to the blade 4 inches deep with mud, and for a few years before the bank came and took it away from us, a boat that had belonged to my grandpa Bill before he went and died. There was a random pile of scrap metal, a bonfire pit, which was really just a burnt spot on the grass that never seemed to stop smoking, and old rubber tires that Mom had painted white and used to plant wildflowers in random places all around the yard. There was a tool shed, a woodshed, an old cinder block garage, and on the weekends, our Mac and Kenworth big rigs parked right there in the grass. To keep the Mac and Kenworth from rolling too far into the yard, Dad brought home a bunch of dirt left over from digging out the latest log road and shaped it into a wedge of sorts, a 3-foot-tall blunt barrier on one end that sloped off to a gentle decline on the other. When the trucks were parked there, they rested right up against that 3-foot edge. But in the spring, when the grass grew in and the trucks were out hauling logs and the rain created little puddles up and down the ramp, us kids in the neighborhood would ride our bikes up the incline as fast as we could and go flying off the edge like the superheroes we always knew we were, shouting, "By the power of Grayskull," as our bikes flew through the air. You have to be committed to the ramp. I dubbed that mound of mud Mountain Spring in honor of all the puddles and named myself its heir apparent, Queen Mary, ruler of the dirt. Even when the bank came and took both the Kenworth and the Mac and left us with no big rigs in need of stopping, Mountain Spring still lived on in their absence, until a few years later when Dad finally broke over and bulldozed it down to make room for a new pile of gravel. And then I became Queen Mary, ruler of the rocks. You have to be willing to adapt as your story changes. Every April, when the thick carpet of rotten leaves in the woods around our house gave way to a flash of green, Goldie would send me packing with a spade and an empty bucket and tell me not to come back until it was full. "Don't just cut the leaves, Mary Ellen. You gotta dig down to get to the good part." I had the route memorized by heart. From the top of our mountain, we had woods in every direction, so for shorthand, we called it the woods in front of our trailer and the woods behind. This path led me to the woods in front. Quick over the hill and down 3 levels of logging roads, veer a hard left at the first waterfall, the one with the fallen tree, skitter down where the ground is nothing but rocks, it's easier if you crawl, and then, just as the hill drops off in a steep, sheer cliff, you should be able to see it, a secret patch of ramps that was just mine and Goldie's. A ramp is a kind of wild onion that grows thick deep in the woods where I come from. In fact, the town of Richwood at the bottom of Fenwick Mountain is so well known for them that it's called the Ramp Capital of the World. And every year they host a festival called the Feast of the Ramson. But as for us, our feast always took place at home. When I got back, Goldie was already hard at work making brown beans and cornbread and frying up bacon in the pan. She'd take that bucket of greens from me, rinse the dirt off more or less, and then fry them up right there in that pan with the bacon grease. Here's something you need to know if you're going to eat ramps. You'll smell like them for 3 solid days after. Not just on your breath, not just up close. It will ooze right out of your pores. The only way to deal with it is for everyone in the house to eat them so you don't have to smell each other. You have to be committed to the ramp. Years later, when I was in law school in New Haven, I went to a fancy restaurant with white linen tablecloths and real cloth napkins, and wouldn't you know it, they had wild ramps right there on the menu. Called it French and gourmet. I ordered them, of course, but I can tell you right now, that fancy French place had nothing on West Virginia Goldie and her dirty bacon grease. We had all sorts of interesting meals like that growing up, like the deer meat the men who worked for Dad would give us every hunting season. Dad was never a hunter himself. I think he lacked the killer instinct. But he sure wouldn't let that meat go to waste. So Goldie would fry it up in the pan and boil some green beans with yet more bacon, and it tasted just like tough, gamey hamburger that had been cooked a little too long. But it was food on the table, so we didn't complain. Sometimes the hunting season was squirrel, so we'd go ahead and eat that too. Goldie turned it into a thick gravy with large chunks of squirrel meat, greasy like dark chicken, and poured it over white bread. I always hated that meal the most. I think it's because at one time or another, we had a pet squirrel. Dad found it hurt in a tree he had cut down, so he brought that squirrel home to heal, and we named it Hector. He would sit on my shoulder and hide under my hair, and we'd feed him cracked walnuts and stale popcorn. When he got better and started running crazy all over the house, Dad took him back to the woods and released him into the wild. And just in time, too, because not long after that he found a nest of baby flying squirrels whose mama must have been hurt or killed, or maybe just abandoned them outright, as sometimes happens. So he brought them on home, and we fed them with eyedroppers until they were strong enough to be set free, too. It was confusing, to say the least. We loved them as our pets, but come squirrel season, you can bet we still had that gravy. You have to be willing to adapt as your situation changes, too. The names we give things have power. Goldie Philistine King was born smack dab in the middle of a total of 13 children her parents brought into the world. Besides her, there were Lee and Gerald, Burnell and Harold, Lena and Edith and Anne, the twins Dora Lee and Aura Lee, one who died at birth, the other who spent most of her adult life confined to a wheelchair in a nursing home from an illness that could readily be treated today. There was Hilbert, who had one arm, and another sibling I'm not sure I ever knew the name of. And then there was her sister Tressie, who ran off to California when she was old enough and never looked back. If you want to know how Goldie's father felt about her, you need look no further than her own middle name. If you were to look up Philistine in the dictionary right now, you'd see it means uncultured, unknowledgeable. I've always wondered what kind of parent would label their child uneducated before she even had a chance to learn. One who saw very little value in girl children, I'm assuming. And Goldie hinted on more than one occasion that when her dad spent time with the bottle, she was one of those he took it out on the most. But one thing she was never subtle about was just how much she hated that middle name. As for me, I just always knew her as Grandma Goldie, one part firecracker, one part sassafras. On Sundays at church, she wore a pink suit, high-collar lace shirt, and white shoulders lady perfume. But back home in jeans and a t-shirt, she could slam a door like nobody's business. Her favorite sayings were, "I'll do it myself," and "When in Rome, do as the Romans do," and "In case you missed it, I'm the dang Roman." At 5'2" tall, she was a towering force in our family tree, a tough woman born of tough Scotch-Irish stock who had lived a brutal life. She was not afraid to get her hands dirty. She was forever out working in the yard, elbow deep in the dirt, planting her beloved butterfly bushes as if always trying to summon some sort of transformation. Instead of waiting on any man in our family to fix something, she got out there and fixed it herself. At least once a week, you'd see her marching down over the hill, shovel in hand and swearing under her breath to dig out our sewer, which was really just a pipe that emptied directly into the woods and had a tendency of backing up. Goldie had short, curly, soft, brown-turned gray hair that she used to get permed once a month into tiny ringlets at the beauty parlor. But now it had turned into a dandelion puff of untamed mane, no matter how many times a day she combed it. She wore large, round glasses, the kind that turned dark in the sun, on top of her even rounder face. But if you looked close enough, you could see her gray-blue eyes laughing behind them. And when she smiled, she had these big apple cheeks sitting high on her cheekbones. Big apple cheeks that she shared with me. She wore full dentures and would take them out every night and put them in a cup of water on the coffee table in the living room, where they stood guard for her until morning. Eventually, she ended up with just a touch of skin cancer on the end of her nose, so the doctor cut it off, the tip of her nose, to save her face, and every time she turned to the side, you could see that it ended in an abrupt hard edge where round used to be. When she got it in her mind to do something, there was no slowing her down. Like that summer when I was 9 and she decided the old garage that stood between her house and our trailer needed to come down. She said she'd take it down herself cinder block by cinder block if she had to, so she hooked a rusty log chain to the second floor window and tied the other end to her old silver Chevy pickup truck, intending to pull out just the frame. But as soon as she hit the gas, just a little too hard, I guess, the entire building came down in one big scrapping heap with a great boom that rattled the windows and shook the entire mountain. When she crawled out of that truck to see what she had done, she stared at me in shock, her eyebrows raised so high they looked like two bees stuck in her dandelion hair. And then she said, "Well, Mary Ellen, that's one way to get the job done." She spent the rest of the summer hauling that building off to the dump, cinder block by cinder block. But come fall, you can bet the job was finished. She was the first one to show me that if you want something in this world, you don't wait on anyone else to hand it to you. You do it yourself. Yes, Goldie Bess was a force to be reckoned with, and she was also my best friend. There's this scene in the movie Steel Magnolias. Sally Field is there in the cemetery after she's just lost Shelby, and she's talking to the other women about how beautiful it is to witness an entire life start to finish. To be there when someone drifts into your life and to still be holding on to their hand when they drift back out. I know that's meant to be about death and loss, but I think it also tells us something pretty powerful about how to look at our own life, too. In any life, there are going to be some scenes we want to delete, some that we want to fast forward through or rewind to get right. There are scenes we're afraid will be too hard for other people to look at, scenes that we're afraid will end up hurting someone else if we include them in the final edit at all. But we forget just how beautiful it is to witness an entire life start to finish. Here's what I know. Those parts of us that we want to hide, those parts of us that we wish we could bury below the surface far away from the light, praying for transformation, those things we think will make people turn their faces away from us in some sort of sympathy, shame on our behalf. For better or worse, those things help make us who we are. We need to roll up our sleeves and get busy about the work of digging into that. We need to get our hands into it. Feel the hard ground break up and shake loose at our unflinching willingness to hold on, to look closer, to see what we didn't see before. Goldie was right. Sometimes you do have to dig down to get to the good part. When I look back on my life, I have a decision to make. Will I see only mud on the surface, or will I also see the miracle underneath? Will I believe that all along I was alone in it? That it really was always up to me to do for myself? Or will I believe that someone else was always there holding my hand, a face that drew close to mine and never once turned away, no matter how far I drifted? Chapter 3. A tiny shift in words that changes everything. When I think of my mother, I think of her dirty, bare feet. In the first few years of my life, Dad went to work and Mom stayed home with me. She'd make me frozen fish sticks and serve pink lemonade in a canning jar. She'd sit me down in front of the TV where I would watch Winnie the Pooh and stay in my nightgown until warm afternoon light poured in through the windows. Then she would turn the radio up and I'd watch her dance a hip, swaying slow dance to a country song as she held onto a broom and glided across our kitchen floor, making mismatched piles of chevron-shaped mud, her bare feet standing in the leftover tracks from Dad's boots the night before. The whole room started to glow golden as if lit from beneath and bathed in brilliant light. The dust stirred up from the broom became glittered, gilded flecks floating on an ethereal, ebbing, invisible current that never seemed to land. For a moment, it felt as though all three of us, Mom, me, and Thomasina the cat, were buoyed up there, floating on a cloud of glittering dirt, our bare feet not touching the ground at all, and Mom still hip-swaying to the music all around us. Those were the golden days of my childhood. Everything was warm, everything was slow, everything was light, and I was safe, safe, safe. When Dad came home from work, he liked to tousle my hair on the top of my head and call me the kid. How's the kid doing today? What did the kid get up to today? Hey, kidster, come here and talk to your old dad for a minute. The kid, kid, kidster. The entire time I was growing up, I don't remember a single time, unless he was talking to a teacher or some other adult, that my father ever called me by my given name. To him, I was the kid. The kid was me, which was extra confusing, considering he was also the one who named me. Dad had never really wanted kids, at least as far as his 23 years of life had taken him. Mom liked to remind me of this often, that she was the one who wanted me, the one who fought to start a family. You know, if it had been left up to your dad, she said, you wouldn't be here now. Dad didn't understand kids, didn't much like them. They cried, they needed things, they weren't really all that interesting. He had already become a young husband, and now here he was being rushed into becoming a father, and he wanted no part of it. For the first 9 months, in fact, every time Mom asked him to feel her belly or show any kind of interest at all, he had none to offer. In the hospital, while everything was still all pink balloons and pink blankets, Dad ran out to buy some celebratory cigars. Not because he smoked at all, and not because he was feeling especially celebratory, but because that was what you did when a new baby came into the world in the 1980s. Smoke cigars with all the men in the hospital waiting room. While he was gone, Mom decided that she was going to name me Renata Ann. She told the nurse and made it official. But when J.R. Bess returned, cigars in hand, he decided Renata Ann sounded way too much like Ramada Inn, and by God, no kid of his was going to be named after a hotel chain. So right there on the spot, he changed my name. He chose Mary after his favorite aunt, and for the middle name, he chose one after his own grandmother. And that was that, Mary Ellen. He named me after two solid, good, honest women who weren't afraid of hard work, because he knew that the life he had in mind for me was going to require a lot of it. Goldie always loved to tell me this next part. She took him by the arm and they slow walked down the hallway to where all the new babies are put on display in their tiny plastic beds, lined up one after another. Before they had even rounded the corner, Dad could hear all the babies crying. He rolled his eyes in a huff. Listen at that racket. I bet that kid of mine is the one in there crying the loudest, just leading the bunch of them. Now, Junior, you don't know that. And sure enough, when they rounded the corner, at least as far as the truth according to Grandma Goldie is concerned, I was the only baby in the entire room who wasn't making a sound. I was just looking around, wide-eyed, wondering what all the fuss was about. And just like that, the cold, hard ground beneath my dad's heart warmed and shifted, and I went from being that kid to the kid from then on after. A tiny shift in words that meant everything had changed in his heart. By the time I was 4, Goldie started taking me with her to church every week for Sunday school. 6 days out of the week, I would be out in a t-shirt and shorts, scrambling up some crabapple tree with skinned bloody knees or hanging upside down from the top bar of the yellow and brown swing set in our yard. Not the regular hanging bar that came with it, mind you, but the very tippy-top crossbar that held the whole thing together. I would stand on the plastic horse swing, when I wasn't using it to play She-Ra, Princess of Power, and pull myself up on the trapeze bar on the far left side. From there, I could use my momentum to flip my legs way up in the air so they would catch on the highest part of the swing set and I could let my arms dangle down toward the ground. I hung upside down like that for what felt like hours, the blood gloriously rushing to my increasingly purple face, my t-shirt flipped up way over my head, laughing deliriously for no...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.